next speaker is Robert Legenstein from Graz University of Technology.
Hi everybody, thanks for the invitation to this great event here. So I want to talk today, start my talk with two experimental observations, discuss their implications for how I think about computational learning in the brain, and then to introduce a theoretical framework which integrates these observations with our classical view of synaptic plasticity. So the way how we think about computation is very much, well, influenced by the standard computation models that we have in computer science, like the random access machine and the Turing machine, which is the classical model of computation in theoretical computer science. And there are many differences to how the brain computes. One difference I want to stress here is that the Turing machine or the random access machine is a static machinery, meaning that the physical implementation of the machine doesn't change during the computation, right? So if you look at, if you would implement a Turing machine the way it's done here, like what you wouldn't do is you wouldn't just change like the wheels during its computing or something. That wouldn't make sense, right? On the other hand, if we look at the brain is on one hand, of course, much more complex than a Turing machine. But the brain, we know for quite a long time now that it is a dynamic machinery in the sense that its connectivity changes over time. So even if you don't learn anything, there's no obvious learning, you see if you image the spines on dendrites over days, that there are spines which appear, spines which disappear. So the spines are the site of the primary site of excitatory inputs into pyramidal cells. So this means that the connectivity is changing in the brain constantly. And other results have shown that this change depends only on learning, also on learning. So what they had here in this paper by Peters, 2014, that they had a mouse learning a specific motor task, and when they start with the training, you see that what is shown here is that addition of spines in the imaging sessions over a time scale of days, and what you see is you have an increased addition of spines in the network, which is followed by an elimination process afterwards. So what we can conclude from that, the observation is the brain is rewiring its architecture in a task-dependent manner. What are the implications of this? First of all, the connectome, which we are trying to look at and which will be definitely an important contribution to our understanding of the brain, does not exist in the strict sense, right? So this means, of course, there's a lot of structure in the cortical network in the brain, but on the final level, there is a refinement all the time, and the connectivity matrix, if you look at it on the microscopic scale, at least, of synapses, can only be a temporal snapshot of the evolving connectivity of the brain, right? Another implication is, for me, that I've been looking quite a bit at circuits and constructing circuits for specific computations to understand computations of the brain. However, we should have a try at a different view. We should try to see what happens if we let the circuits construct themselves, right? Can they find architectures that are good for the computation they have to do? And according to the data that we have, the brain is doing that in some extent. And I will argue, or I want to argue, that this synaptic rewiring, so this rewiring of the circuit, is a necessary mechanism for the brain in order to achieve its level of performance and functionality that we are used to. Okay, second observation is about plasticity. So when we work, so this was also about plasticity in some sense, but if we look at plasticity from a theoretical point of view, we often write it as a function, you know, of, so this would be a parameter, synaptic parameter theta, And the change of the synaptic parameter delta theta would be a function of maybe the parameter itself, of some pre and post synaptic variables, as well as maybe global factors, right? Now, the maybe surprising, maybe not so surprising fact is that plasticity in the or synaptic dynamics in the brain are actually to a large extent stochastic. Okay, so this is from a work by Dworkin and Siff, and they estimated how much of the plasticity at the synapse or of the dynamics of a synapse you can attribute to pre and post synaptic history dependent processes, and which you how much you cannot explain in this presumably this is an assumption now because it's not completely clear it is like this, but presumably stochastic would be more than 50%. Okay, the question is how do we arrive at that conclusion? They have a clever setup. You know, if you have two neurons in the brain and they're connected, they're usually not connected by single synapse, but by several synapses. And some of these synapses even target the same dendritic branch, right? Now, if you look at this pair of synapses which target the same dendritic branch, it's easy to understand that these synapses have the same presynaptic variables, right? These presynaptic spiking, as well as the same postsynaptic variables on the branch, like the branch voltage, the postsynaptic spikes, and also dendritic events and spikes there. So one would assume that if they have, if they are deterministic and changing according to the same learning rule, they would arrive at a similar weight. So what you can do is you can consider the correlations between these synaptic efficiencies of such pairs of synapses on the same dendrite and of pairs of synapses on different dendritic branches and compare that. And you see that the correlation of the weights of these synapses is actually only 0.23. So it's very far away from highly correlated synapses. Also, they experience the same pre- and post-synaptic variables. And some more calculations leads to the conclusion that there is a lot of these spontaneous, presumably stochastic changes. So implications for that, from that is instead of looking at these deterministic learning rules that we actually usually get by looking at data and fitting a deterministic function to a highly stochastic data points, we should rather consider looking at rules that where you add basically noise to that, right? And that's what we did. The question is, what kind of noise should you use there, right? And there have been some studies about that, for example, by Löwenstein or Yasumatsu, and they have looked at the changes of spine sizes over time and tried to describe that with a stochastic model. And the model they came up with was a Ornstein-Ulmbeck process, which seems to fit the data very well, right? So Ornstein-Ulmbeck process is in principle quite simple. So the part here is simply noise. So it's a Wiener process. In discrete time, you can think of it as just Gaussian noise that you add to the changes. And you have this deterministic term here where you have your parameter, and basically the change of the parameter is just given by the difference to some mean. So what this does is basically it pulls the parameter towards this mean mu, and in addition to that you have the noise, right? So without this here, we would have only the noise and the parameters would diverge. Of course, this cannot be the case, so this here kind of bounds the divergence, and what you get basically is a stochastic process where these thetas here are kind of pulled to the mean value, but they are actually stochastically fluctuating around that. And to get an Ornstein-Ulmbeck process, actually the synaptic efficiencies have to be proportional to the exponent of this variable theta that describes the evolution of the synaptic efficiencies. Okay, and when you use that, you basically get log normal distribution of spine sizes or of synaptic efficiency, and this is what you exactly also see in the data, and many people have shown that this log normal distributed spine sizes are very common in cortex. All right, so so this was about the fluctuations. Now I'm going back to the idea of rewiring. Of course, what happens here is, you know, you have these fluctuations here, the spines that grow and shrink, and when they are becoming very small, they disappear, right? And sometimes spines will appear and you get new synapses there. So to model that in a simple way, the way that we thought about that was that we are basically looking at this feature, and the feature encodes whether the synapse is connected and disconnected. If the feature is, the theta can be positive and negative, the weight can only be positive, so we only look at excitatory synapses in this model. But when the theta becomes negative, we say the synapse disappears, so the spine is small, it's below some threshold, and the synapse is so to say disconnected. But the theta can still fluctuate around here on the negative scale, so on the negative side, and when it comes up by chance again, you will see kind of a dendrite grow again, and the synapse is going to reestablish. So basically, if theta is smaller than zero, if it's disconnected synapse, if it's larger than zero, we have a functional synapse, and then if it's functional, we also have this exponential dependence of the weight.
Yes? Distinguish between these non-functional, sort of silent synapses and some that are actually non-existent. So it's a question whether the synapse sort of is just not there and then kind of cannot even notice whether it would be useful, but these could maybe notice that they would be useful.
We actually do not distinguish between these two types. However, here, according to the mathematics that we will have later, when the synapse is disconnected, usually the deterministic part will disappear, or like say the activity-driven part will disappear, and you only have the random fluctuation. So the synapse can, in our model, at least in the way that we looked at it, cannot see whether it's going to be useful or not. It can only see whether it's useful when it randomly appears again.
So only functional synapses can see whether they're useful or not.
Yes, exactly. All right, now this is kind of describing basically what they have shown in the experiments, but this is not very useful, right? I mean, a network with this dynamics wouldn't learn anything. It just has this kind of log normal distribution of spine sizes. So our main contribution is that, first of all, we introduced this rewiring, and the second contribution was that we are generalizing this to integrate it with general learning rules. Yes?
Is there a fourth category, which is synapses that don't exist? In other words, or
oh, yeah, sure. So there are potential connections which could be established. And I mean, in the model that we're having, basically, you could have a potential connection, and this one has like this dynamics. And if two neurons say they can't be connected at all because the axon is completely somewhere else, then you couldn't even have a potential connection.
So there are five categories. In other words, there's not existing but potential, and there's not existing and not potential?
So in our model, we have basically three categories. Impossible synapses, so potential synapses that are non-existent, so not established, right, when the theta is negative, and we have established synapses when the theta is positive. All right. So we are generalizing this equation here, and what we're doing basically is we are replacing this deterministic part with a general term, and this looks a little bit odd, but it's actually a standard term basically. So now what we're having here, the general stochastic differential equation that we are considering, is one where we have the noise term, we have still the Wiener process, we have introduced a temperature parameter which can scale the noise. And we have this deterministic part, and we write this deterministic part in this particular way, and you will see why later. And actually, this is a standard formulation. If you look at it, we have some p star of theta here, which can be seen as something like a objective function that you want to optimize with your learning rule, right? And then we do some kind of gradient descent on this objective function. Okay, so that's how we can interpret it, but we will see what it does exactly later. Right, and this is basically it. We combine this with this rewiring that I've discussed just on this slide before. Okay, so what does it do? Now the analysis goes as follows, right? Because we have this stochastic term, you cannot say where the synaptic parameters will evolve exactly, right? But you can say something about the distribution of these parameters, right? If you start somewhere, like 1 minute later, it can't be far off, right? It will not have been changing completely, so you can say there is some distribution around this initial point that you started at, and then this distribution will change over time, of course, and you can describe this distribution in this simple equation, and this is done exactly by the Fokker-Planck equation, which you don't have to look at all. I just put it here so that you see that it describes the evolution of this distribution of parameters over time, and the question is now what happens if you do let it evolve for very long, right? And what will happen is under some mild conditions is that it will reach a stationary distribution, which you get basically by using this equation and setting it to zero, which means there is no change anymore, right? And you get the stationary distribution. And how does the stationary distribution look like? When you solve that, you will see for T, for this temperature being 1, if we set this to 1, it's exactly P star of theta. Okay? So what that means is when you have this kind of plasticity process, the network is producing parameter settings which are sampled from this distribution on the long run. All right? So let's look first at the deterministic part. Let's say this is gone, t is 0, so we have the deterministic part only. In this case, you would just have like this gradient ascent on p star of theta, so that means if you start here, you will end up in a local maximum. Together with this noise term, you don't end up in a local maximum, but you're kind of always have this noise around that, and it will explore kind of the space, and it will reach every single, on the long term, it will reach a single point in the space with the probability p star of theta. There was a question?
Yeah. So now p star in the top equation is an energy, and in the bottom equation it's a distribution. Mm-hmm. So that imposes some constraints on the energy function, right? So you're doing a gradient ascent and not descent on the energy function?
It's a gradient ascent, yes.
And it should be a non-negative function, I guess?
Of course, it's distribution non-negative. It's normalized, right.
Probability. So the energy function must be defined in a way that's a problem.
In this case, to get this theoretical result, it should be probability distribution, and it should be differentiable. Twice differentiable, actually. But all right, so if we do this, so it looks like this looks quite kind of, you know, abstract, right? For example, you could use now p star as being a Gaussian, just a Gaussian distribution, a Gaussian priority parameters. If you do that, you get back the Ornstein-Ulmbeck process, and then the network samples from a Gaussian distribution over the thetas, and because the weights are exponentially related to theta, you get a log normal distribution of this, right? So this just is an example that you see how you can use this in a simple setup. Okay. Now we have used this general idea in the number of different examples and used it for learning in networks of neurons and spiky neural networks. So the first example is an example where we used it for reward-based learning. Okay, so reward-based learning is an important paradigm for learning in animals and humans. We learn a lot from rewards, and there are many, of course, experiments where we have this reward-based setup. So this is a natural thing to look at. And for the reward-based setup, how does this p star of theta look like? So in this case, I said it's kind of your objective function, and what's your objective in reward-based learning? Basically, you want to optimize or maximize the discounted reward given your parameters. So this could be one part, the expected discounted reward, and another part could be some prior on your parameters. Say you would like to have a network with sparse connectivity or with a log normal distribution. You can write this in this prior, and then you can have here so to say, the second objective of getting as much reward as possible, and then P star of theta would be proportional to this product between these two factors. Okay, and now to what you have to do now is to compute like the derivative with respect to the parameters of this, and in principle this has been done often. Many people have done this. We have done this as well. Gerstner group, Seung has done this, and it's just the basic thing. So if you do that, what you end up with is a learning rule, which is a reward modulated or reward gated STDB-like learning rule in a spiking neural network. Okay, so I don't show this obviously, but you're assuming here you have now a spiking neural network. You assume you want to optimize the reward that the network gets. You derive this learning rule according to this equation. What you get is a rule where you have STDB updates that are accumulated in an eligibility trace, and then whenever a reward comes, the weights are adjusted accordingly. So. Yeah, I don't want to go into more details of this, but this is more or less standard, and what we add to this is now the noise term, right? And this would give you now an algorithm which does not really optimize the reward, but it samples from parameter settings which are good with respect to getting a lot of reward, right? So we've tried this out, and we tried it to see whether we can use this to model some data from experiments. And here we've chosen one experiment from Peters et al., where they had the following. They had a mouse, which was operating a lever, and whenever it got a cue, it should like push the lever, and then it should pull it back. And that would give a reward, right? So basically, it had to learn some kind of simple motor behavior. And at the same time, they had imaging from motor cortex. And in motor cortex, you can see this nice assembly sequences there. So this is two-photon imaging. And you see after learning, basically, you get nicer sequences. There's less noise here around, as well as you get a better representation of the movement directly after the cue, OK? In addition, they were looking at the spine dynamics, and this is what I've shown you already before. So this is the experiment to this figure where you see that there are spines created when the animal starts to learn, and afterwards there's some kind of elimination. Okay, so we made a simple model for that. I mean, this is an unstructured model of motor cortex, so to say. We have inputs which indicates the cue. We have spiking neurons, excitatory inhibitory here. And we have special populations which control the movement of the lever. Those one, spiking of those neurons would push it down, and spiking of those neurons would pull it up. And so we use this reward-modulated plasticity rule there. We use the rewiring as well. So what we have is just kind of a circuit, a potential circuit structure, so to say. And the structure is evolved also during this learning with the rewiring that we're having. Okay, so the circuit is able. Yes.
Inhibitory neurons are trained the same way as the excitatory neurons.
Inhibitory neurons are not trained.
Okay, so it's just.
Yeah. We only train excitatory synaptic connections. Right. So the network can learn that. It also has similar features than they have there. So do you see when we sort the activity of neurons before learning, you see some kind of sequences, but they are noisy after learning. They are much less noisy. You get a better motor behavior, so to say, which basically solves the task. And you see that we have a better representation of the sequence directly after cue onset, as they have it here. But what is more interesting, actually, maybe, is to look at the dynamics of the parameters. So the dynamics of the parameters, the question is, will it now like sample in the space, right, as I proposed? And so basically, here we have PCA. of the high-dimensional parameter space in a network. You start somewhere with the synaptic efficiencies and also with the network structure, of course. This is also integrated. And then it goes, it learns, and basically after 4 hours, it finds a good solution. The color here says whether the reward is good, so whether the movement is done well or not, right? So when a red color means we have a good solution, and here we have a good solution, but the parameters don't stop here. They continue to change, right? So now here, if we continue training for 18 hours or so, there will still be a lot of change. However, the movement is still very good. So the task is performed very well. And a different way to view this is to view this in a space where we have a transformation into task-relevant and task-irrelevant dimension in parameter space. So this is a hypothesis that because you have like this large parameter space, there are many, many possibilities how you can solve the task, right? There are many different parameter settings which solve the task, and there are some dimensions in this parameter space which are relevant for your task and others are not, right? Now, there is this DPCA projection which extracts this, and then we plot the reward on top of that two dimensions. You can nicely see the reward depends a lot along this dimension and does not really depend on the second dimension. And what happens is exactly what we are expecting is that you start somewhere, the network learns to increase the reward, and then it stays somewhere there where the reward is good everywhere, right? So the prediction of this is that you will never see like static parameter settings in the brain, but rather they are always changing, and even the representations may change over time. And this reminds us of the changing of the place fields in hippocampus CA1, as has been shown by Sif et al. Yes.
Left side, it leaves the good regime, right? Goes to a bad regime.
Oh, this is something we'll talk right now. Sorry. What we did was, at this point here now, we completely perturbed the system, okay, to see what happens, okay? We perturbed the systems, and what we did was we reversed the functionality of these two populations, right? Now the network did completely the wrong thing, right? It just pushed and pulled in the wrong direction. And then we looked, will the network be able to compensate for that? And yes, it did. So this is initial learning. Now we have this perturbation. Now we are changing the way how the network controls this lever, and it does completely wrong afterwards, but it will, after some time, compensate for this change, which is expected to some extent. But the interesting thing is that the rewiring mechanism that we're using here is really essential to do that. If you don't have that, so if you would fix the connectivity at this point and you would try to relearn it, it wouldn't be able to relearn it. And the reason for this is that it has learned a good connectivity matrix, basically, for the task. And this one is, however, completely not useful for the other task it should learn. So it wouldn't be able to compensate for this perturbation. So this is just kind of one idea how this rewiring could be useful in terms of compensating for changes in task or in network structure or in any kind of parameter changes that you have. All right, so in addition to that, we were looking at some kind of characteristics of the circuit, of the dynamics, and we see, yes, we are having a similar kind of changes in the addition of synapses and in the deletion of synapses. When you do here this change in the task, you see that a lot of new synapses will be created afterwards, and then lagging a little bit later, you get a depletion of synapses, similar as they have here. I mean, it's only qualitative, right? We did not look at this in a quantitative manner. Yes?
I'm just trying to get a little bit of intuition about this. If you were sitting on top of one synapse in the course of this process,
yeah,
and during this wandering process through the set of parameters that all lead to good rewards, would you be noticing that one synapse's weight was sort of stochastically, you know, was some kind of random walk-looking thing, or?
Yes.
That's what you would see.
You would see a random walk-looking thing,
so
yes.
Individual synapse would be minutely perturbed, and yet
yes.
all of them, you know, from moment to moment, but all of them together would leave the system in a high-functioning state, or one that's...
Yes, I mean, there is, like, exactly, the dynamics have two components, right? The random component, which perturbs everything, but there is also a kind of a drift coming from this gradient, which tends to push it also to a good direction.
So there's a tremendous redundancy in this system to be able to just wander all over the place and still perform well. And now, I'm wondering if that's an artifact of an incredibly simple task.
Yeah, the task is really very simple here. I agree.
Building a memory. Can you imagine mapping this onto a...
I think this, I mean, I will show you later a task which is, or several tasks which are much more complex. However, not with spiking neurons, but maybe we can come back to this at this point. I mean, in this case, you're completely right. I mean, this is a very simple task. The network is very much over parameterized here. And just note one thing. You remember this stuff we had in the beginning about the estimated stochasticity of synapses. The question is, does our model fit to that? And of course, in our model, we cannot really say that because we have this parameter t, and this chain, like this scales how much you would have here of this blue part, right? But we can say one thing. Let's look at the circuit and let's look at temperatures where you are having a good performance, right? And we see that there are temperatures, there's a broader range of temperatures where we have good performance, so between 0.5. So this temperature, it scales the amount of noise in the learning rule, right? If you look at something here, you see that in this range you get similar results and you also get similar estimated stochasticity of the synapses. Okay, this is just a sanity check. It's just showing you that we're not completely off, basically, the data. Okay, but now I want to shift gears a little bit. Now, this task is really simple, right? And any kind of guy who's working in machine learning would say, okay, what's the point, right? Now, we were thinking about how can we apply this to a much more complex task. Okay. The problem at the point when we were doing that was it was really hard to train spiking neural networks for complex tasks. Now, today it's a different thing. We can do much more. You will hear this in a later talk. But at this point, we were just thinking, the framework is so general, you can apply it basically to any kind of network model and any kind of learning model, right? So the framework just, this is the whole framework, right? That just says you have some kind of plasticity, you add noise to that, and you add this rewiring in this very simple way, right? You can apply this to an artificial neural network, and you can apply it for supervised learning as well, right? And that's what we did. So we were looking now at deep neural networks, supervised learning, but using the general framework for rewiring and for stochastic plasticity within the setup, right? So this is not telling you anything about biology now, but it tells you something about what's the potential of this approach, right? Can it really be useful, or is it just like these toy problems that you used to see with spiking neural networks? Okay, now, we did that, and basically we developed a learning algorithm which is based on, you know, the standard back prop, but now with rewiring and with this noise. And this algorithm we call Deep R. And what it does is basically we're taking at this prior now a constraint on the number of connections, an L0 norm constraint, which means we really constrain the number of connections in the network. We say throughout learning we only want to have 5% connectivity, so a fixed number of connections in the whole network, right? And then you can just use kind of the cross entropy error function here to define this distribution or something, and you get kind of a backprop which is constrained to connectivity and which is to some extent stochastic. Okay, this is the algorithm we get, And we applied this to a number of problems, standard benchmark problems. We tried MNIST, but I'm showing you here Cypher 10, which is slightly more complex than MNIST, as well as TIMID, which is a temporal data set. And we used the convolutional network here. And then we looked at our algorithm deep R, which is in green here, and see how well it performs for different connectivity percentages. So 100% would be the fully connected convolutional network, and 10% would be only 10% of these connections are really realized. But the algorithm rewires those connections throughout learning, right? And what we see, if you have like 15%, you're really close to the baseline of the fully connected network. It's really very close here. And in addition, at any of these connectivity schemes here, it's better than the well-known state-of-the-art pruning algorithm by Han et al. And the difference is the pruning algorithm actually starts with a fully connected network and then prunes it after training, whereas we started with the sparse network and just rewire, right? And I think this is really necessary, of course, because you don't want to start with a fully connected brain and then rewire that. I mean, there is some kind of pruning, we know that, but still, you're really severely limited in the number of connections that you have in the brain, right? So I would claim that this rewiring is really a necessary mechanisms needed to have useful, good learning in the brain. Okay, we did the same thing with TIMID. Here we used an LSTM recurrent network. It worked extremely well. So here we were, for example, at 4% connectivity, we had very good performance on this data set. It's a speech data set. And just to give you an idea what that means, this is a fully connected network layer, 400 neurons, 400 neurons, 100% connectivity. You don't see any neuron. You don't see any connectivity because everything is connectivity here. Now I prune that 4%. OK, it looks much better, right? So this is a reasonable connectivity scheme. And this is the connectivity matrix you see. It's nicely sparse. And it's something you could imagine that can be implemented in a limited system. All right, so let's go to the conclusions then. I want to add something to the discussion we had yesterday, neuroscience, machine learning. I think I've shown you in my last part that the ideas that we have in neuroscience can very nicely be ported to ideas in machine learning. And as Matt Botvinnik told us, or was writing in his paper about neuroscience and machine learning, usually it's not the exact algorithms that you port, but rather these general ideas like rewiring or something, which are very useful. And I think the same is true in the opposite direction. The ideas of MCMC sampling is not an idea that came out of neuroscience. Still, it's something that we use to analyze the dynamics of the connections and of the parameters in our network. Right, then we found that you can actually use this kind of rewiring algorithms to get good architectures. So I would suggest that we should make use of the self-constructing capabilities of neural networks, which are proved to exist in the brain. And finally, what we can offer in this direction is a theoretical framework for understanding stochastic network plasticity and rewiring in the brain, which unifies all of that. And with that, I want to thank you. And I want to thank collaborators, David Kappel, who is did most of the work on this spiking neural network rewiring, Guillaume Bellec, who did the rewiring in the artificial network, and also Wolfgang Maas, of course, who is very important in all this work that we're doing in the lab. Thank you very much.
My question is, in your learning dynamics, kind of the stochastic and the deterministic parts, they compete on an equal level in the sum. Would you expect actually improvements if you would go to a cascade model where the deterministic change is actually on a higher level, and then just if a synapse is not consolidated, the randomness takes place and removes it?
This is a great question. This is something we do not consider at all, right? Consolidation obviously is an important point, because if you look at if you think of it, I mean, it's nice that you have like this this noise there, but if you have it like this, there is no way to consolidate any knowledge or something, right? If you would have learned something and then you don't learn it for a while, you would completely forget it because it's just wiped out by the noise, right? So consolidation is an issue, and definitely I would think that if you use some kind of a cascade model, you could use that to stabilize memories and consolidate stuff that you have learned.
It would still be compatible with the data?
That's another good question. I don't know that. I just know the data that I've seen, but about consolidation, yeah, one would have to look into that.
Are there actually so good data on consolidation?
What?
Are there so good data on consolidation?
No, I was just asking for the data you showed.
Yes?
Did I get it right? So if you can afford a full connectivity, that would always be better than the prune?
Not necessarily. Not necessarily.
Is there really an advantage of having sort of, in your simulations, of having a reduced connectivity?
Yes. Actually, I didn't tell you that, but if you look at this graph. So here we're having, this is the baseline of a fully connected LSTM from the literature. So here, lower is better, actually, right? And this is with pruning. It's better, and the reason is the pruning is, or not pruning, the rewiring, or the constraint on the connectivity is a regularizer. So on the test set, you're doing better.
So another question, Bartlett mentioned in one of his talks that he had sort of good results when the synapses would be not effective, but they would be sensitive sort of to whether they could contribute or not.
Okay.
Synapses are just, they're there, but they don't notice whether they would be efficient or not. Maybe just a remark that it might actually be interesting to consider synapses that are not doing anything, but they're sensing pre- and post-synaptic signal in order to figure out whether they might be useful.
Right, so this goes back to these three classes of having like silent synapses as well. So we don't have this. And we just wanted to make sure in our model, like, we say if a synapse is disconnected, I mean it's not a silent synapse, it's really disconnected, then it cannot sense anything. But you could have an additional things, of course, where you have like a pre-stage where it senses, and there was another question?
All right. Just a comment. This may depend a lot on what the learning problem is, because and also the area of the brain where you look. So this is a little known fact, but in the hippocampus, when people have looked at the, kind of done EM and looked at spine size and postsynaptic densities and so on, there appear to be two classes, mm-hmm. big, strong ones, mm-hmm. and they have several properties that mm-hmm. are distinct from the little, weak ones. And mm-hmm. when I say weak, I mean fewer AMPA channels and things like that. But the weak ones appear to make up, maybe those are the silent ones, appear to make up 90%.
Yeah.
So it's almost like the strong ones, right. Maybe the ones that are involved in representing information for long periods of time, don't even get noticed because they're a tiny fraction of the population, whereas there can be a lot of turnover in the weak ones, and there is a lot of turnover, which is always puzzling. If you have kind of a memory system, why you should expect turnover of synapses? It seems like it would be washing out memory.
Mm.
Anyway, it's an interesting. So maybe that large population of relatively weak synapses is primarily sensing,
right?
Waiting for the moment to be potentiated, and then it becomes promoted. So it's just a possibility.
So I mean, and you're saying the strong ones are really stable, right?
Apparently.
Yeah. So that would be kind of.
They're really built up. Big postsynaptic densities, perforated.
Nice. Yeah.
The paper I'm thinking of is by Menon. It's the first author mm-hmm. of the paper. It's an EM study in the hippocampus.
Thank you. Yeah, I should look at it. Yeah, yes?
I wonder if you could comment on the relationship between your stochastic rewiring ideas and the diffusion of weights proposed by Tishby in the context of stochastic. Stochastic gradient descent.
Oh, it's a good point, actually. Right. It's related. I mean, if you have a stochastic gradient descent, right, you have noise which is introduced into the learning, by the stochasticity of the training examples that you see. This is some part of noise which you have there. And that could be seen as part of the noise that we are modeling here. So I think there should be a relationship. I mean, one difference is that in our case, we are not dependent on this noise on the training examples, but rather we add this really directly. But I agree there is, you get some amount of noise from this stochastic.
Yeah, it'd be cool if the biology takes that in without needing that.
Yeah.
Don't you automatically have noise from training examples?
Yes.
So you're basically adding extra noise.
We add the extra noise to that, exactly. Yeah.
I have a comment to Bartlett's comment, whether or not this kind of coming and going of possibly weak synapses has any functional implication. So I'm aware of now two papers, one in hippocampus, the other one in area PPC from Driscoll and Harvey, which showed actually when they checked, you know, say the place cells in hippocampus then over weeks, then that they change substantially. So this suggests to me that at least on this level of neural codes, now you see this drastic drifts in code. In the paper of Driscoll and Harvey in Neuron last year, it was now kind of apparently related to neural code for learned behavior, and this was also drifting drastically over the set of weeks then, right? So it could still be that there's somewhere hidden skeleton which doesn't change then, right? But at least one has to say on the level of neural coding, what one records, no one sees really the cells respond differently week after week.
Okay.